pastor here at this wonderful church of Notre Dame, of course dedicated to Notre Dame de Lourdes. And also, tonight we welcome back, of course, les amis du Collège du Bernardin. And that, I know those buildings hold on since the 1960s, when I was over in France with Combelli, and we were leading les barricades de Mai, once a week. And yes, I was there then. And then I stayed a few more years to make believe that I was actually getting a full degree at the University of Paris, and then came back home. And ultimately, the cardinal here was bluffed by all of that, and he still made me the pastor of this wonderful French-speaking parish, actually trilingual parish, because you know we're French, English, and Spanish. But we are making sure that the French have a lasting impression, as they have since they returned here in 2013. Father Michael and I have been here since 2011, preparing the way, something like John the Baptist, but this is John the Paddock, not John the Baptist. And so we welcome you all, and of course to, as you know, a subject which is extremely important for Christianity. The title is The Protection of the Middle Eastern Christians. But of course it goes beyond that, because we know the problems throughout the world, and the persecution, once again, of the Christians. And if we lose the Christians there, we could lose Christianity partout dans le monde, everywhere in the world. So this is extremely important, so I welcome the topic, and I welcome the panelists. But first I'm going to ask Thomas to come forward to talk a little bit about the Collège des Bernardins. Thomas.
Thanks, Father, and thanks for always hosting us here.
It's a
great pleasure to be here. So my name is Thomas Crow. I'm part of the Friends of the Collège des Bernardins. The Collège des Bernardins was founded in 1248 by Stephen of Lexington under the Pope Innocent IV. And it was always a university, a research center, until the French Revolution. From there, the building was taken over. It became a prison, a firehouse, residence for police academy students, and it was almost abandoned. And in the early 2000s, the Diocese of Paris basically bought the building back under the patronage of Cardinal Lustiger, and they started renovating the building until 2008. And then they, you know, brought it back to its original mission of basically to be a place of knowledge and faith in the heart of the city, and to renew the dialogue between the Christian and between the Christians, wisdom and society. And so basically, what happens day to day at the Collège des Bernardins is there is a research center that covers a number of topics, and I'll encourage you to go on the website and check it out. And then it has a number of, you know, it's a center for people to learn and listen to conferences and people speak, and then it's also an art center with, you know, where they display a lot of art and have cultural events. Actually, President Macron was there about a month ago to talk with the various bishops and to talk to the French Catholics. So here in the U.S., for the last 2 years, we've been bringing people here a few times a year to talk about different topics, and we're trying to get the Collège to be known. There's about 250,000 people that go and visit the Collège every year in Paris, and about 500,000 people that go on their website. And I know a lot of the videos and audios on the website are in French, but there's a great part in English as well, and I'll encourage you to go. So, with any further ado, I'll let Francis and his panelists come on stage and talk about our topic tonight. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Monseigneur, for welcoming us. Welcome to all of you to Notre-Dame de Lourdes. My name is Francis Dubois. I'm a former Imaginations official, and I had the privilege to serve in easy countries, 2 years in Gaza, I was in Iraq until the war, until the invasion, then in Algeria, and I was the representative in Tunisia. I was always very, very interested in interreligious dialogue and knowledge about faith, so I was delighted to be invited by the Collège des Bernardins to be the moderator of this panel. I heard yesterday that Pope Francis appointed three ladies at a very important role in the Curia as consultants in the propagation of faith, and one of the ladies is Belgian, from Belgium, and is from the Collège des Bernardins in Paris. So this is another great credit to this Collège des Bernardins. Without any further ado, I would like to ask the panelists to introduce themselves, and then we come to the core of this wonderful subject, the protection of the Christians in the Middle East.
So just to introduce myself right now, as Monsignor Paddock mentioned, I've been here at Notre Dame since 2011 with him, Father Michael Halloran. I have a long, checkered, and suspicious background. I was raised Catholic and educated by the Jesuits, very dangerous, in high school and college. As a Jesuit in college, I became a Jesuit for 5 years, after which, since they introduced me to the spiritual life, I became enamored of God. I became a contemplative monk in the Carthusian order. Aragon Chartreuse, prayed in France, Vermont, France, and England for 22 years. I was in silence, making up for it now. Then came back in 1994 to New York and serving in parishes in Manhattan and the Bronx since then. So I was received as a priest of the Archdiocese in 2009. And that same year, I also became a sensei in the Zen tradition, so I'm a Zen teacher also, and very involved in interfaith work nationally and internationally. So I'm thrilled to be able to deal with this wonderful branch of the spiritual tradition of humanity and of Christianity tonight.
Thank you very much. Abuna.
My name is Father Gregory Serafin. I'm a priest of St. Mary and St. Mark Coptic Orthodox Church. The parish is actually located on the Upper East Side. It's on 62nd Street between 2nd and 3rd. And that location is actually a former Catholic church by the name of Our Lady of Peace. And so we've just been there for about a year now. So my history is not as colorful as Father's, but I was born in Egypt, came when I was 4 years old. My father actually paved the way. He had interviewed for a job at the United Nations. He came here in 1977, retired in 2004, but since then we as a family came or migrated in 83. The rest of the family migrated in 83. We grew up here. This is and was always our home. We did visit Egypt regularly, so we never really forgot the roots. Knowing this, we also, as a church, migrated to the States in the late 50s, early 60s. The Coptic Orthodox Church is an early immigrant church here in the States, only 50 years young, I guess, compared to many other churches that have migrated earlier. And so there was still a need to hold on and to grasp heritage and to hold on to culture. And so we, as a church, did grow here. We did have a very closed community. What changed was in 1999, where such people as myself and many other first, second, third generation Copts needed something that was more real for them, I guess, in terms of language, in terms of culture. Growing up here, it was okay to wear baggy jeans and shorts and tank tops, and it was just a little different than what our very conservative Egyptian church was. Back in Egypt. And so we decided to start the parish that I serve now in 99. Having this church became really a safe haven for many people. Many, again, first, second, third generation Copts, youth. We became also probably the number one most attended church of intercultural marriages. So you would have an Egyptian-born person married to a non-Egyptian person, which was something also very unheard of or different from the typical. And also having myself as being ordained in such a church with an all-English service with Coptic, minus the Arabic, was also very different than any other parish throughout the states. We have about 250-plus parishes right now in the U.S., and the St. Mary and St. Mark's here in the city is a handful of those that only speak English and or Coptic. I've only been a priest for about 3 years now, so since we started the church in 99, the first parish full-time priest was myself, who was ordained for this church and for this purpose back in 2015.
Thank you very much, Abuna. Dr. Hassan, please.
My name is Hassan Azad. I have a PhD in Islamic Studies and Religion from Colombia.
Louder?
Oh, closer. Thanks, pardon. Beautiful. Okay. So I am currently working on a Master's in Divinity at Tiedemann Theological Seminary. I had a conversion experience from Islam to Christianity. I was a practicing Sufi Muslim, very happily practicing Sufi Muslim for 15 plus years. My PhD, as I mentioned, is in Islamic studies. I know the tradition quite well. All of which is to say that I wasn't prepared for the conversion experience that happened in 2016, which makes sense. It was a conversion experience. I attended a Methodist church on Easter of 2016 and decided I wanted to take communion, and I took communion, and my world was turned upside down. Some might say, I think I would say today, my world was turned the right side up. I subsequently was baptized in the Eastern Orthodox Church on Christmas of 2016, and on the 13th of this month I will be ordained as reader in the Eastern Orthodox Church.
So thank you very much. I think we should give an applause to those very extraordinary. Start with Father Michael. Give us an overall situation of the plight of the Christians in the Middle East, their situation.
Yes, thank you. So I'm going to do that first of all to show how what has been happening in recent years in this 21st century, particularly in the Middle East as regards to Christians. And then I'll say a few words about the significance as we understand it now in the Roman Catholic Church. Of the Eastern Catholic, Eastern Christian spiritualities and churches. Just a few words about that. You can get a presentation of that on the excellent panels in the back that Vincent set up for us. The statistics I got, you can find them for yourself on the Christian Near East Association, which is a prominent, Catholic group that monitors what goes on in the Christian Near East. I often have to correct people who say, Western Christianity is a European phenomenon and it's a Western phenomenon. And I say, no, where are you getting your history? Christianity is Middle Eastern. All great religions are from the East. So we got ours from there. And let's not forget that to begin with. That's where our origins are. With the people of the Middle East. Europe just plugged into that more or less successfully. But the current plight, they list Iraq and Syria as the most serious, and of course that's no surprise to anyone currently with ISIS and the civil wars and all the terrible things going on there. They mentioned that in Iraq, in the 1990s there were 1 million Christians. By 2006, there were 300,000. It was after the Iraq War. With ISIS, by 2014, there were 140,000. And now, today, there are only 50,000 left, which means 5% of what it was 20 years ago, which is disastrous and tragic. So, can that ever be restored? And remember, these are the most ancient, going back to the early centuries of Christianity, the most ancient Christian cultures, way before Europe got involved. You know, Greece, of course, and Italy, but the earliest Christian churches and cultures are there in the Middle East. So we should hold very close to our Syria. There were 1 million there. By 2010, there were only 220,000. And today there are 120,000. So a little over 10% of what there were, barely 20 years ago. And of course, the situation there is intolerable. So we have to hold that in our heart, what kind of solution we can find. Of course, Egypt, I'll leave to my esteemed colleague here to say, according to the statistics on the website, in 1910, there were 19% Christian Copt in Egypt of the population. In 2010, only 10%. The statistics there on the back are a little different. Maybe my colleague from Seraphim will have something more to say about it. It's the largest Christian community in the Middle East, the Egyptian Copts. And many have immigrated to U.S. and Canada, as we are seeing tonight. Very privileged to have that. You mentioned in Israel, it went, it's gone from 3.7% to 2% Christian. Many different churches and nationalities, of course, there in Israel. In Jordan, it's actually gone up a little bit to 2% because of the 30,000 that have fled from Iraq into Jordan. That's not a stable situation at all. Lebanon in 1937, there were 53% Christian. Today there are only 40%. And many different, Maronite, Melkites, Syrian, Armenian, Antiochian, many different church bodies there. In Jerusalem, and this of course just before the creation of the State of Israel, there were 20% Christians in Jerusalem in 1946. It's down to 2% today. Of course, all sorts of political and international issues that are involved with that. Jerusalem and Palestine in general. So it's a very, very dire situation. The Christian population, perhaps even permanently declining because of the war and unrest and the terrorism that are going on there. And it's a very, very tragic situation. So it's not only a human drama and a human, a socio-political disaster, but it's a spiritual disaster. And this is the second part of what I want to say tonight, just to point out the significance globally, spiritually, of Eastern Christianity. Pope John Paul had a very famous image, very expressive image, which I'm sure you've all heard of, the two lungs of the church, of the Christian community in the world, and that the Western Church, the Roman Church or the Western Church, is only one lung, and that the Eastern Church is the other lung, and that we can't, well, like Pope Francis, he can maybe breathe with one lung. He literally has one lung, but maybe that's a metaphor for our current situation. The Pope of the Western Patriarch is only breathing with one lung. I mean, that is absolutely a commentary, maybe designated by God, foreseen by God, of our situation. Pope John Paul wanted in his own lifetime to bring the Eastern and Western churches together, but of course that wasn't going to happen because it was Pope John Paul. And what I mean by that is too insistent on the prerogatives of the Western Church, and until we in the Western Church reform our view of ourselves, the union is not going to happen, but that's my view of it anyway. But nonetheless, he recognized the truth that we were only breathing with one lung. What the Eastern Church brings, and this again is Pope John Paul, you may know the apostolic letter which he issued in 1995 called Orientale Lumen, the Eastern Light, or the Light from the East, in which he presented this basic truth. And anyone who studies theology or spirituality knows that certain values are preeminent in the Eastern spirituality, the Eastern Christian communities in general. A deep emphasis on prayer, on mysticism, way more than in the Latin Church, which loves laws, and rituals and rules. In the East, there's an immense, from the very start, a great emphasis on the interior life, on mysticism and on the, you know, the mystical aspects of the liturgy. But you also find in that is a share in the divine life, the Trinitarian energies in the cosmos, a cosmic sense of the liturgy, cosmic sense of the spirit of spirituality, of the great Eastern emphasis. We just celebrated Saint Athanasius two days ago, one of the four great doctors of the Eastern Church, as we even recognize in the Western Church, who emphasized deification, theosis. We are deified, we share the divine nature. That's the mystical quality of sharing the divine life. Nobody ever talks about that in the West. They're scared to death of that, because how can you make rules about that? Sharing the Trinitarian life, you can't legislate that. So, very uncomfortable. But if you only have rules and, you know, the customs, you know, then you're going to cough yourself to death, but desiccate. You know. That's why you really need that all along, because you're missing the whole half, more than half. You know, I think it's the most important half, the most important part of spirituality. And he outlines this, Pope John Paul, very well in that apostolic letter, speaking of all these things that I've just mentioned. So it's crucial for Christianity, certainly for Western Christianity, to reconnect with that organic element of our own tradition. And in order to do that, to make sure that Eastern Christianity survives, physically, as well as theologically and spiritually. And finally, to realize that this is the way we have to move forward, by integrating this. One final comment, if you look at the diagrams on the back, the Pope is just the Western, the Patriarch of Rome. There was Patriarch of Antioch, Patriarch of Alexandria, Patriarch of Jerusalem. We have to get back to our correct placement in all of this. We're just one of the patriarchs. A lot of controversy over Constantinople, which we can talk about that later, which is not one of the original patriarchates. To regain reconnect with our own deepest tradition, and finally, Protestantism. We lost a lung in 1054. We lost another half of our lung in 1517, which we just celebrated with Martin Luther. So we're breathing on kind of like between an eighth and a quarter of a lung at this point, with a resurgent Tridentine spirituality, which is all twisted and tortured, and tiny, partial, total emphasis on the sacrifice, total emphasis on other worship of the Eucharist, all these things which just mean we're breathing with 1/16 of a lung, and we don't even know it. So this is crucial, not only in humanitarian terms, not only in historical terms, political terms, but in spiritual and theological and ecclesiastical terms. This is essential that we heal this in our world and in our church today.
Thank you very much, Father Michael, for this overall view. I would like to ask the Abuna, Father Gregory, what is your stand in coming from where you came from, the situation in Egypt, and what you can do on this side of the ocean?
So from the perspective of the Coptic Church, we are surely very active or very pro-unity. Dialogues have become a very big thing only in the last 20 years, unfortunately, but it is something that we as a church truly attribute to our Lord Jesus Christ's message of unity, in that if we are truly a Christian church, then we are one body, and we are to go back to being that one body, united in Him. And so the analogy on the lungs, or the lung, or the half lung, or the third of a lung, or the eighth of a lung, definitely resonates very much. And to be very frank, I mean, the Coptic Church was essentially part of the one church. And we had broken away in 450 AD. So that was the first true break in terms of the Oriental Orthodox churches way back when. Although, again, apostolic, and we could draw the lineage back to St. Mark the Apostle back in 64 AD, and the Gospel of Mark was written in 42 AD, it truly hurts us, knowing and seeing that we are a broken church. And so in order for us to be able to mend these things, or the last, I guess, 1,500 years of division, there has to be dialogue, and there has to be a call to come back and have such events as this interfaith dialogue. 1 year ago, we had a very tragic event, one of many, in which there were bombings on Palm Sunday. Two simultaneous bombings on Palm Sunday, one in the province of Tanta and the other in the city of Alexandria at the same time. And so on Good Friday, only 5 days later, we in St. Mary and St. Mark's Church on 62nd Street were blessed by this outpouring of love of so many faith leaders throughout this region. And it was a beautiful thing to see. We had, on that day, we were visited by His Eminence Cardinal Dolan. We were visited by Archbishops Demetrius of the Greek Orthodox Church, Archbishop Khejak Versilian of the Armenian Church, Rabbi Joseph Potasnik of the Jewish religion, and Pastor A.R. Bernard. And we, on that day, he couldn't make it, but also Imam Tariq. And so you had all these leaders of different faith organizations or different faith religions coming to show unity, solidarity, a message of peace and hope together. And that, especially on Good Friday, finding, again, a rabbi visiting a church on Good Friday is a very difficult thing to grasp or even witness. But that really was a beginning to something very beautiful. And we know historically Tertullian says the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. And if it wasn't for the blood of the martyrs of Palm Sunday, such an event couldn't have taken place 5 days later. Because then the Catholic Church wouldn't have reached out. The Western or the Eastern churches wouldn't have reached out. The Jewish rabbi wouldn't have reached out, or the Protestant pastor wouldn't have reached out, or the Muslim imam. But there is definitely a greater vision here for such leaders. And although, again, there's tragedy, there could always be triumph in the process.
Thank you very much. Dr. Hassan, what is your view on this situation from a personal perspective?
I think one has to take a broader historical view of things with anything. If we're going to do meaningful, if we're going to have a meaningful discussion about things. Historically, and I say this as a Christian today, before you, Christianity's track record vis-a-vis other traditions isn't particularly one to write home about, or at least one to. You can't say that it has a good track record as a theologian. The historic track record that Islam has, the Islamic tradition, Muslims, vis-a-vis other traditions, on the other hand, historically speaking, is a pretty decent track record. And this is just, and the fact that we have a brethren, Coptic Christians in Egypt who are suffering persecution today, is testament to the fact that Muslims did not only accommodate Christians historically in the Middle East, they were, I mean, this is a theological point, and it may not be popular with you today, but I have to be honest to my research, and it's not, I'm not making a particularly original point in this regard, this is well recognized by academics, which is that, theologically speaking, in the Quran, it's, as a Muslim, one has to accept the, on some level, the validity of the other traditions. This is just a theological reality in the Quran. And I say this as a Christian, which is maybe somewhat paradoxical, it is certainly to me, that in Christianity, theologically speaking, it's very hard actually to accept other traditions. It just is. And I think there, in more recent years, certainly amongst, I'm currently doing my master's in divinity at Union Theological Seminary, which is a great center of Protestant, historically Protestant, theological speculation. I think that there have been some great strides made as far as interfaith discourses of various stripes and shades and gradations that have been done by Protestant theologians, and I think Catholic theologians are finally catching up, right? And Eastern Orthodox, speaking as an Eastern Orthodox Christian, there's work that still needs to be done. Why do I say all of this? I say all of this to, I guess, again, I only have a few minutes to talk about this, but I wanted to touch upon some important points, which is that the Western projects in the Middle East, these have been going on for a long time. Let's not forget about colonialism. I am British today because my forefathers, my parents originally come from Bangladesh. I am British today because colonialism happened, right? And this isn't to say, oh, everything's to be blamed on colonialism. No, and colonialism has historically played a significant role in carving up these various lands, and these intrigues continue today. Not under the guise of colonialism, but under the guise of whether democracy, let's bring democracy to the world, to the rest of the world, or whether under the guise of the so-called war on terror. And I have had occasion to say that it's a war on terror, it's a war on slash of terror, because those who are on the receiving end of it, they experience it as a war of terror. And why do I say this? In 2000, excited about this because these are real existential issues for so many people, Christian and otherwise, around the world today. I believe in 2015, a Nobel Peace Prize winning DC-based physicians group published a report where they looked at the number of casualties, the number of civilian deaths that have happened in the Middle East as a result of the war on terror. They estimate between 1.3 million and 2 million people have died as a result of Western, specifically in particular US, but Western efforts to stamp out terrorism. Why do I say this? I say this because one has to, if we're going to begin to try to do some justice to the incredibly complex issues that are on the ground here, we have to try and take as